Hello, and welcome to another edition of Movies to Video Games Review. Episode 115. For this episode, it will be The World Is Not Enough. The version being reviewed in this episode was released in September 2001, published by EA Games, and developed by 2N Productions, and was released solely for the Game Boy Color. The World Is Not Enough, the 19th movie overall in the long-running 007 James Bond movie series based off of the book series by Ian Fleming, and the third with Pierce Brosnan in the role of James Bond. The movie was a financial success, taking in $361 million worldwide, but was met with mixed reviews overall from critics and fans. Either way, it would lead to another film with Brosnan in the lead role. The movie would be adapted to three different video games, one for the PlayStation, one for the Nintendo 64, and another for the Game Boy Color, and all games being very different from the other. As per usual with the James Bond film, a lot of familiar faces will return from previous adventures, along with a whole new cast of characters to pad things out properly. In the title role for his third time playing British 00 agent super spy for MI6, namely James Bond, 007, is Pierce Brosnan. One of the main adversaries for Bond to hunt down this go-around is former KGB agent turned really bad, Renard, who is portrayed by Robert Carlyle. No Bond movie is complete without female love interests, and this time we have two. Sophie Marceau as former kidnapped victim of Renard, and Oil Harris, who is seemingly worried about Renard targeting her, portraying Electra King. Denise Richards as a nuclear physicist named Dr. Christmas Jones, who will assist Bond along the way with her knowledge in the field. Rounding out the rest of the cast, we have Judi Dench returning as MI6 head M, Robbie Coltrane reprising his role from GoldenEye as Valentin Zufkowski, Desmond Llewellyn as Q, Samantha Bond as Miss Moneypenny, and making his debut here as Q's assistant, we have John Cleese, who in this movie is referred to as R. The World Is Not Enough has Pierce Brosnan returning as MI6 British Super Agent 007, as he is assigned to protect Electra King after her father, a rich oil tycoon, is killed at MI6 headquarters, and the man who they assume is behind the death, Renard, is on the hunt for nuclear weapons. James has quite a situation to deal with, where everyone is not who they may seem, and one turn leads to another. Luckily, he has the assistance of a nuclear physicist, Christmas Jones, to try and defuse and hunt down the nuclear devices that were taken by Renard. Not so luckily, the head of MI6, M, gets taken hostage and is put in harm's way. Of course, there is Q and his new assistant dubbed R there to help Bond with the latest and greatest, not to mention the return of an old sorta kinda ally, Valentin, to really make things interesting. It is quite a romp all over Europe, and as long as you can follow the complicated at times story, should all lead to another solid entry in the James Bond series of movies. We've already looked at the console versions of games based off of Brosnan's third outing as Bond. One more to go, as this time we take an in-depth look at the game made exclusively for the Game Boy Color. Time to polish up that pistol and get ready for our debriefing, as it's time to get on to the review. The World Is Not Enough for the Game Boy Color is an overhead perspective view shooter, free exploration, mission-based, secret agent-themed experience that will also have selective moments that are side-scrolling action-based in nature as well. The portable game is very bare-bones on options, with the game not providing varying difficulty or other options in the game's 8 different levels. James Bond will be the only character you'll have any control over for the entire run of this game. Let's begin this one and see what we got ourselves into this time. Of course, we'll get the game's company and MGM logos proudly displayed before we get the sorta kinda recreation of the movie's famous gun barrel sequence. The screen will lock on an actually impressive looking start screen, for a Game Boy Color game at least, with the movie's logo and title and images of some of the main characters greeting us. Pushing start takes the player to the main menu screen, where you can start a new adventure, continue a previous one using a password, or tweak some of the options. Guess we'll just start her up then and get into a new adventure. A headshot of M will be shown on a mostly dark screen as she gives us a very short mission briefing that you can cycle through telling what her mission ahead is to be. and then the objectives of the mission listed after that. We'll get a very pixelated movie image of the location we are now in, Bilbao, Spain. And thus, our adventure within this movie's storyline begins yet again. We start out exploring the first floor of the bank as James Bond, in a mostly empty set of offices, keep moving about, opening doors until you find a key card that's laying on the ground in one of the rooms. Then you work your way to an elevator that you can now access by pushing a button on the wall near it. You'll enter it and are automatically taken to the fourth floor to meet the banker. You're escorted in and, you know the routine if you've seen the movie, text appears on the screen where LaChase, the banker, tells Bond to take the money. Bond wants a name of who killed a fellow agent. LaChase suddenly gets shot by Cigar Girl and the action starts. Guards now turn against you and you can pick up a gun that's laying on the floor and shoot at them to remove them for good. Grab the money and now you have to work your way back down to the first floor. And of course, the elevator suddenly doesn't work, so we have to do it the old-fashioned way, down the stairs we go. Each floor will be swarming with guards, and you can either shoot or punch them, or just try to avoid them altogether, as you aren't required to kill a certain amount of guards to complete the mission. Your only real mission is escape with the money. And, well, that's all there really is to the first stage. Explore each of the four levels in the bank, as you look for a way to find the stairway, and deal with the guards one way or the other. Pick up needed items for weapons and health, and, well, that's your level. Nothing too complicated here. Reach the first floor and just walk out of the front door of the stage. You only had to beat the guard guarding the door. You'll get taken to a debriefing screen that will show your stats on how well you did overall, and another cutscene picture capture from the movie will follow this before we're given a password to use, and the story just continues on as we head on to the second stage starting moments right after this. This all may seem like this is a very easy game ahead based on what was just experienced here, but I assure you, fellow game players, that first stage was not a proper sneak peek of what is to come in this game in the next 7 levels that will follow this one. The displays in this game are kept simple and to the point, more so than the game itself turns out to be. What they provide is more than enough to get you through the game, and is easy to see what you need to take note of with a quick glance at the already small screen, and will all be located on the bottom portion of the screen in a horizontal boxed off area. On the bottom left of the screen is a red colored bar, and this is your health bar. It's actually the most important display, as once your health is depleted, well, that's it, game over. No extra lives, no body armor to find, heck, there's not even any checkpoints in this game. You die, that's it. Back to the beginning of the stage no matter how far you just got through it. So keeping this at its highest possible point is the real goal of this game. Thankfully, very thankfully, they do provide health restore items that will look like blue crosses in white circles that will partially refill the health meter when you find them. The bottom right of the screen will have a box with a set amount of circles in it, and this is the objective tracker. This is kinda not that useful, but at the same time can be used as a quick reference either way. You'll start with some empty circles in the display, and each time you achieve an objective, a circle will fill in. And the amount of circles located here will be the amount of objectives that the level you're currently on has. The last display in the center bottom of the screen is one you will be referring to often though, and this is your currently equipped item display. This is where you go to change your weapons and items available. You of course will have your default issue pistol that they once again call the Wolfram P2K, and this is a real chore to use. You would think the main weapon, the one he'll be able to pick up on most of the 8 stages of the game, will at least be an average and decent weapon to use. Well, it's not. It fires super slow and it's not very effective for removing enemies found all throughout the game. It takes 4 shots to kill any enemy, and it'll really slow this game down to ridiculous points as you're trying to line yourself upright and count 4 shots each time you do so, hoping that your shots hit, and the enemy's return shots don't hit you in the process. Just an awful mess. They do have other weapons, not that they're much better. They'll have things such as rapid firing weapons of different types that will fire multiple slow moving shots at a time, and it still takes 4 bullets having to hit an enemy to defeat them. Even though there are differing weapons in this category, they're all very similar, and just as useless really as your default pistol. Of course there are item pickups in the form of ammo boxes, with each ammo type specific to the weapon you can get on a stage to refill it. Most probably won't even use the weapons, as you can get through the game by avoiding enemies, or the other option for defeating enemies, the unequipped options, which is just Bond with his fist. Since the guns are so ineffective and slow firing, you will quite often find yourself just unequipping your weapon and attacking enemies with your punches, trying to remove them that way. Honestly, never expected the weapon used to be so lame in this game, and it really does break the game really badly. Other weapons found in this game that you can pick up include sticky mines that you can use to blow up barriers in your way, the grenade launcher to attack a helicopter, remote mines that you can detonate from afar, and the best, the taser, that'll knock out enemies instantly and has unlimited charges in it. And yes, it's a Bond-based game, so of course there'll be some items and gadgets, some being the key word, as there isn't too much else here in these regards. You can actually get the car for a moment on one stage if you have the car keys, use your watch to open cell doors with the laser that emits from it, and you can pick up access cards to use as keys on some of the stages. And that's really about it as far as extra items and gadgets go. I guess I can't be too disappointed, as it's a Game Boy Color game, and what do you expect, but to say that the weapon usage is disappointing in this game would be a huge understatement. This would be where I talk about all the various enemies in this game that you'll go up against. As yes, there are a lot of confrontation moments with enemies in this game, but the problem is, on every single one of the 8 stages, you fight the same exact grunt enemy type. Doesn't matter where you are, what situation, or if it fits the storyline. One clone after another, all the way through. No matter what, you will always be going up against the green uniform, cap-wearing, Caucasian-toned military wannabe all throughout. It doesn't matter where you are, it's the same exact guy as 100 clones or brothers or cousins or whatever they want to call them that you fight non-stop. But that doesn't mean they all fight the same. They are differing in that some carry weapons that they fire at you, just as slowly as your weapon fires too, by the way. Some have pistols, some have rapid firing weapons, some drop grenades on you, and some can only use their fist and will try to melee fight you right off the bat, unable to do anything else as they approach you. I thought the other games based on this movie had very little variety enemy-wise. Well, this one takes the award hands down for lack of enemy variety. Most of the times you will wind up avoiding these grunts anyway. Walk past them and after a short while they'll give up on trying to stop you. You can shoot them even if they are off screen, as long as you hit them 4 times, they are removed for good. And of course the AI for these enemies is just awful. They are there to give you something to deal with, but not a problem in the slightest for the most part. There isn't too much in the means of moves and abilities that we'll be able to perform in the game experience. Other James Bond based games really try to mix it up a bit and give Bond a lot of things to do to make the whole secret spy aspect of things come to life a bit more. This game is limited in what it can do, so it's kept to a minimum. You will be cycling through your weapons for the most of the game with the push of the start button, so that you can use them if you choose to do so instead of punching out enemies in your way. And there's a lot of exploring about through various levels that are mostly linear in nature, but there are select moments to actually explore and backtrack as well through some of the more spread out environments. And you can actually interact with some items found on the stage itself. There'll be moments where you have to use computers or activate devices by pushing buttons in the proper order and the similar. Pulling levers to raise and lower lifts you need to be on to get to other areas of the stage. But even with all these little extras, they just come off as cheap gimmicks thrown in here and there to stretch things out a bit, as it really is very limiting in what we can actually do for most of the stages. It's mostly just walk about in an overview perspective screen and explore, use a weapon, and interact with a device here and there to work towards meeting objectives, which are usually find an item laying on the ground or a person who is not that hard to find, and make it to a certain area of the stage which you have to get to anyway. It felt like here that the objectives are really just there because they have to be in a James Bond game, but don't really amount to much in things you aren't doing anyway due to the limits of things we can actually do. The action moments where we can actually jump on platforms with Bond does add a little more depth to the game. But of course these moments are harder than the rest, and usually involve Bond having to avoid enemy dropping bombs from above, making very difficult jumps, and having to go through paths again and again until we get it just right. Well, I really wish there was more that Bond was able to do in this game. It's quite limiting and lacking for the most part, and a Game Boy Color game can accomplish a lot more than what is showcased here. The first two stages lull you into a false sense of security as you play this, making you think that this is a cakewalk, a fun little portable game that has you walking about as James Bond, doing mundane things and dealing with very slow and mindless enemies. And while a lot of this stuff is still found throughout the whole game, Level 3 shows us that they did indeed come up with some ways to make this game challenging, frustrating, and quite difficult throughout. So yes, they did mix things up a bit in this game and offer some varying level types that we have to get through. And the fact that this is a one life and that's it attempt to get through any given stage is what really makes this a very hard game overall. I already walked us through how the first level plays out, and that is your basic stage type setup with some other aspects added into later stages to provide more difficulty. The first varying type is my all-time favorite, meaning my least favorite, the sneaking stage type. Yes, it's back again, as we've seen in other games based on this movie, and it's just as bad and frustrating as you remember. Actually, it's worse in this game for some strange reason. Stage 4, Night Watch, takes place at Electra's Villa, and as James, we have to sneak about without being detected. And you can't shoot anyone, of course, as that too will alert others. The guards will walk about in pattern-like formation, and you have to walk by them when they are either off-screen or with their backs facing you. Sounds easy, but it really isn't. So if any of the guards see you, text will appear above their head that says, HALT, and it's instant failed mission. I would suggest that any playing this game get used to the word HALT, as you'll be seeing it often. Especially in this particular mission. They even have security cameras moving about that can see you, along with randomly flashing lasers on the ground that we have to work through and try to turn off by finding two separate switches that deactivate each set, and then you have to backtrack and figure your way out into the next area. And this stage, with the sneaking about aspect, goes on throughout various areas and moments of the stage, from inside the villa to outside of it, as you have to sneak about through shacks and narrow passages. Sadly, after you do all this by some miracle after the 110th trying to do so, Stage 5 in the nuclear facility has more sneaking about needed, as you have to infiltrate the area secretly for unknown reasons not related to the movie, without being spotted until you find Christmas Jones. If a guard sees you, halt. Yep, you know the routine by now, game over. Back to the start of the stage again. Thankfully, after these two stages, that's really it for the sneaking about moments, but even one stage was way too much for my liking. But if you want another frustrating and teeth-grinding moment, let me introduce you to the end of Stage 5, where it's now an action stage moment that we're thrust into. Bond has to chase after Renard, who's getting away, and will have to jump on platforms, over energy-draining spikes, avoid enemies from above dropping explosives, all while having an unknown time limit through this obstacle course-like stage, as doors are closing in front of us, and if we don't make it to said door in time, we're trapped and it's mission failed. And if you somehow get through all that quickly, you have to work your way all the way back in another limited amount of time given, and use explosives on those same doors that closed on us previously to get out while picking up one explosive found per stretch and moving away from it as it explodes so we don't get killed by it. There's moments in the game where you have to use your watch that you have to find somewhere in the stage to open a cell, avoid bombs dropping from above, avoid landmines placed in hidden areas that you have no way of knowing where they are. Moments where you have to push buttons to activate items, not fully sure what you opened or activated until you explore about. Use computers without knowing which computer you have to use in a row. How you're supposed to know what to do in all these stages with these aspects is beyond me. So yeah, there you have it. The level and stage setups for the most part for the stages of this game. Sounds like fun, right? It's the movie jumping right out at us here. Believe it or not, there's only one boss battle in the entire game. You see a lot of the baddies in the game at various points as NBC during gameplay, but you never really get to fight or confront any of them. Which is quite disappointing, as part of the fun of getting through some of this sludge that this game has to offer, is that you at least get to deal with one of the main adversaries from the film at the end of it. But nope, not here. That would have made too much sense. The one boss battle we do have is that same one we keep on having to deal with in games based on this movie. You know the one, with the helicopter. That had those saw blades attached to it that showed up in the caviar factory that Bond had to defeat. At the end of the sixth stage, after you worked your way through all the usual stuff found there, you're now in an open area with lots of ladders and platforms. And your car, something that is just like the movie, which is a nice touch actually, is just sitting there. So grab the car keys that are just laying there and enter your vehicle, and you'll be taken to another screen with a crosshair on it. You can get two attacks on the helicopter from your car, given that you fire at the right time with the crosshair turning red and you push the fire button as it tells you to do so. And this will make your life a little easier, as it will require less attacks to get the copter for the rest of the fight. After you take your two shots, exit the car, and well, that's it, so much for the car in the game. Oh well, at least we got to sit in it for 2 seconds. The rest of the battle will be you moving about on various ladders and platforms as the helicopter moves in very pattern-like formations. You now have to use a new weapon found here, the grenade launcher, which only can hold 2 grenades at a time, before you'll have to pick up the available ammo that keeps respawning on the ground before it to refill it back up to 2. The sawcopter will start to cut away parts of the platforms above to show you that it is indeed a sawcopter that we're dealing with here, and the battle isn't difficult per se, if not just long-winded and annoying to get through. The weapon as usual fires very slowly, and there's really only one or two areas that are ideal spots to take a shot at the copter to try to hit it without getting hit in return by it. And you'll have to time your attacks just right as it's about to leave the screen, hopefully hitting it before it does so. You get used to it after a few times, and it's just avoiding and working around the screen in sync with the copter, moving back to that one spot again that's the good one to use and firing back at it. Shoot at it 8 or so times and it'll be destroyed for good, ending the stage and the only boss battle moment found within. Well, at least it's something different and definitely of a boss battle type situation, but with it being a Bond game and with how many villains are actually in this movie that he dealt with, it needed a little more than just a helicopter shooting scene. The game will have little to no extra features. Even for a Game Boy Color game, it feels quite slim in its features and offerings. There's no multiplayer, no difficulty settings, no unlockables, heck, you can't even save the game in a file. All the game provides is a password feature so you can start at any level you reach as you play through the game. You can access the password screen by selecting continue on the start screen, and as you cycle through various James Bond related icons, like microfilm, a crosshair, or a gun, entering that one that matches the one you just got. But at least they do have a password option in this game, otherwise it would have been a real chore to try to get through this all in one sitting. Sadly, there isn't anything else really found in the base game. They do implement the other characters from the film in either game start moments with M telling you the mission via text, and you walking past or getting a brief, very brief moment to see other characters. So, sadly, if you play this, it's just the base game and nothing more to enjoy, making for a very quick one-and-done type of play situation. The game will take us to many of the locations as we've seen in the film, definitely not all, and a few vital ones are bypassed, but you do get the flavor of everything as it unfolded in the movie, starting out in Bilbao, Spain with the banker situation, back to London at MI6 headquarters, where the baddies have infiltrated it and Bond has to secure the area, before he heads to the Thames River to chase down Cigar Girl, where instead of a river chase, we're now running about in a subway station next to it. Two sneaking stages, with the first being in Baku, Azerbaijan, sneaking about in Elektra's villa, then off to Kazakhstan to meet up with Christmas Jones trying to stop Renard from getting a nuclear missile. Off to the caviar plant to meet up with Valentin and destroy that pesky sawblade copter. To the final stretch of the game, we're in Turkey as we have the escape catcher, and the last stage of course takes place in the submarine to take care of Renard and stop him once and for all. They picked a lot of vital moments from the film, and we aren't anywhere that we really shouldn't be besides being in a subway station rather than, again, actually getting to do the river chase scene that is so iconic in this movie. Also, the lack of the casino, skiing situation, or even a bullion moment are noticeable omissions, as the story seems to go by very quickly with what we do get here rather than those moments added in. I've made no secret that I am not a big fan of games on the Game Boy Color graphically. For some reason, I still think regular Game Boy games look better even without the color. Everything is colored very dully in this game. A lot of blues and browns used throughout. The same exact looking henchman is used for every single stage of the game. That's just not acceptable to me graphically. As per usual with a Game Boy Color game, none of the characters have any facial features, and it looks quite bad on Bond as you walk around with just a box for a head as he marches along oh so slowly in all those gray box floor pattern areas. Nothing looks great in any of the areas that we head to actually. Even the James Bond barrel shoot moment after we load up the game looks just weird for lack of a better word to use. Yeah, it's a Game Boy Color, I know, but it's kind of funny more than setting the mood and recreating the situation properly. The best aspects of the game graphically are in two places, and they are all while the gameplay itself is not actually occurring. The start stage mission briefing showing M's head with the text appearing is not what I'm talking about actually, as Judi Dench just looks downright creepy here with how they did her image. But Pierce Brosnan in the debriefing screen adds a very nice accent to the otherwise boring screen of text on a black screen area that we get. And the start screen to the game showing some moments from the movie poster was also recreated nicely. Can't say the same about the movie cap pictures that they squeezed in here that don't look good at all. Definitely such moments don't belong on this system, and instead of trying to squeeze those horribly rendered pictures, they could have used the space of this game to add different enemy types perhaps, or even another level with a little more going on than what we do wind up doing here. Sadly, there isn't much to enjoy here graphically. The displays are bland, the stages are dull, and the moments where you try to implement images or character headshots from the film itself either work just okay or look downright awful. And yes, the play controls are poor too in this game, but the controls themselves are easy enough to understand. The control pad will move you about in the direction it's pushed. The A button does an action, while the B button fires a weapon or uses an equipped gadget. You can cycle through items with the use of the start button and view the progress pause screen with the push to select button. And that's all there is to the controls in this game. Such a simplistic control scheme, things should be easy enough to deal with, but of course they aren't. Firing your weapon is overly slow and awkward at many times. One of the best aspects of Bond in video games is that he has many weapons to use to take down all the baddies trying to stop him. Well, in this game it isn't much of a battle, as you fire a shot and hope it hits and avoid their counterfire as you move about on a tiny little area while doing so. You'll resort to the much quicker and to the point punching aspect, where you just have to hit the enemy a few times up close and knock him out for good. But it's far from satisfying, and even has to be timed just right to pull this off properly. The action stays, where it's side-scrolling in nature and you have to jump about on ledges, is hit or miss, and when you finally do get to jump in this game, you'll wish you didn't have to. It is very hard to line up your jumps right and judge where the jump will take us, oftentimes not hitting the platform right and falling off instead of landing on it. Other horrible control moments deal with the sneaking about stages, where you have to avoid being seen by the enemies who will scream halt as they do see us. It's not clear what the line of sight is, how close you have to be too close, when you can sometimes just walk by them no problem and other times they'll see you instantly. Sure, you can use a taser on enemies, at least in these moments, but that too was slow firing and you had to get very close to the enemy and hit them for it to work properly. Controls and setups in this game are just clunky and forced. Walk up to the terminal to try to get it to work. Hit switches all over to turn something off somewhere. Sneak through laser lights on the ground and having to be very careful not to get hit by said beams with the flaking controls. It's not that anything didn't really work as it's supposed to, it just all was so slow and lumbering and repetitive seeming that there's no energy or desire to keep doing these same motions again and again throughout a stage. There's no real way of knowing what pushing a button did, or what computer out of many to interact with, or that you're supposed to interact with one even. It just left to guessing and bumbling about in this game. This is not an easy game to get through, and it will take a lot of time to do so, with the need to redo stages many a time, password having to be used to come back to the stage you left off at a later time. It took me about 3.5 hours to get through the game. It'll definitely vary depending on how good you get at this game. As we work our way to the 8th and final stage, which of course is the submarine in Turkey, we're just glad to have made it here at all, as it definitely wasn't easy getting here. Thankfully, the 7th stage, where we are escaping the castle in Turkey that Elektra captured us within, is not too difficult a stage. Strangely enough, there's no final confrontation with Elektra, who just kinda slinks away into darkness after the beginning of the stage, never to be seen again, as we just walk out of the castle after navigating through it properly. So, the last stage is the submarine, and thankfully this is not an overcomplicated mess like the N64 version, but far from as much fun as the PS1 version setup was. For this stage and this game, you pretty much had to find explosives that you had to use to destroy computers in the control room. And of course, said explosives are all over the stage, and you had to go through various corridors of the sub, dealing with enemies who guard the areas and finding said items and working your way back to the beginning to use each of the explosions on said computers separately. So pretty much a stage to draw out a simple situation for all it's worth. After you finally get all the computers in the control room destroyed, it's time to find Renard and end this experience, as the last path is now opened up and you can push a button to open up a locked door that you couldn't get into prior. And it's back to the side-scrolling action moments to end the game. Yay. And it will take a while. Full of tiny ledges, walls to block you, moving platforms, and tiny little in-air rectangles that you'll have to leap towards. So, it's kind of straightforward. Jump on ledges, then to moving platforms, climb ladders, do more of what you just did in the next part of the room, up and up we go until we get to the higher point of the room. The moving platforms are now charged with electricity on them, meaning you now have a limited amount of time before you have to jump off of it before it'll charge with electricity on the return trip. One moment of the room has a wall with narrow areas within it that you have to work through after jumping off one of these platforms, and you have to make it through all that after trying many times of having to fall down and missing jumps and working your way back to this point. But after a lot of trial and error and attempts, you'll finally make it to that last ladder of the room, and Renard in a pink outfit for some reason is waiting for you. Punch him once and that's it. Game over, you win. You'll get a final debriefing screen followed by a quick image showing the escape from the sub with the word victory written below, and well, that's all we get. Well, that wasn't worth it. In all honesty, it's about all I expected though, so can't say I was surprised with the lack of ending that we do wind up getting here. No, that's definitely not it. Oh boy. Well, the music is as unrelated to James Bond as you can get, and definitely as far from the soundtrack from the movie that it's based on as you can get. And they could have at least put the Bond theme on the title screen, if nowhere else, to try to show a little effort was put into matching things properly. But nope. What we do get is just some barely done generic music that only passes for the Bond theme like in the most minor of moments here, and there is where you can see they try to throw in a few notes of the song in before it deviates into something just as far removed from the original song as you can get. The songs used in this game are slow, with a lot of pauses, and that annoying hiss and static sound being heard constantly hurts the game, as it's nothing you want to hear while you're trying to get through this already difficult as it is situation. So nope, nothing good to hear here. I guess the best advice I can give is don't play this with headphones on, and perhaps turn down the volume a bit. That may help make things a little more comfortable while playing this. A little bit, at least. The World Is Not Enough, for the Game Boy Color, is not a very good game. It's a very weird game in that it sort of kind of follows the storyline quite well with its locations, objectives, and characters found within, but it's a far from playable or fun experience at any time while trying to get through its 8 stages. The game isn't a disaster when relating to the movie. It has many of the story elements within. We visit a lot, not all, but a lot of the vital moments. It has mission objectives being told by something that sort of kind of looks like Judi Dench's head at the start of stages. It gives us areas to sneak about and use weapons and gadgets, so there's something here sort of kind of to work with. But the game only sort of kind of gets it right, and everything else that is wrong with it is what is more memorable from the game's overall experience. For one thing, the game is way too difficult. A game such as this should not be this hard. They'll start the game off with an uneventful easy breeze stage, and then they turn it up 20 notches once we get into stage 3, and the sneak about stages after that are even worse. Play controls are not very good, firing weapons just plain sucks, and trying to figure out what we're supposed to do takes too long. Sneak about stages are awful, you'll get used to seeing the word HALT appear on the screen until it's permanently imprinted into your brain. You lose more lives by being seen than actually being killed by an enemy, as the AI is poorly done in this game. Some bonus content would have been even nicer to have us at least looking forward to something else here. Having to restart the stage over from the start anytime you lose a life is really ridiculous in this type of game setup. Sure, it works in a console first-person shooting game, as they're built and designed totally differently than a game like this. A situation that could have easily been fixed by providing either checkpoints to restart at, or even a life system. They do have that one boss battle in the game, which is actually a good thing, as the game needed more of that here. It's just too bad it's a long and drawn-out situation where we wind up shooting up at a copter when it's at the same point after it does pattern-like movements all the while. And the music? Well, I've already mentioned in detail how awful that is, and I'll leave it at that. So, there really isn't much here, unfortunately, to enjoy. It was a lot worse than I thought it would be. I really hoped for more and got less when all was said and done. It's not even satisfying beating a stage or beating this game. You feel so unfulfilled having to go through these long stages you have to keep on attempting from the start, only to get some end screen showing some meaningless tallies and move on to the next to do more of the same. The game is a good example of why sometimes you shouldn't bother trying to make a portable version of something that was done much better on its big brother console versions on the market at the same time, as those versions pulled it off a lot better. Sorry, nothing to see here. This is definitely an avoid type of game when all is said and done. It looks bad, plays bad, sounds bad, and well, I guess that makes it bad. I definitely didn't have fun playing this and won't recommend it. With that all said, that ends our look at games based on The World Is Not Enough. We had the good, the okay, and the bad. So, a little bit of everything for this movie. Be sure to check out the reviews of the console versions of this movie series if you haven't seen them yet. And of course, be prepared for James Bond to return in the future, as there are many more of his movie-based game adventures to look at here. For now though, this game is gonna wind up getting the slow-firing, watch-where-you-leap, ear-bleeding music playing, I need a martini after playing this one score of... And that's all for this edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Please be sure to check back soon for the next video game based on a movie review.